Hi, I'm Sue Johnson. I am host of Wake Up and Live with the Arts. And I am here with one of our long-standing members of the Wake Up and Live's Actor Studio. He, like our videographer, James McGillbray, and our veteran videographer, Lester Bryant Sr., is Gary Webster. We go back many, 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 many days.
Well, this is the last day of February 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And the first Wake Up and Live function that I was involved with was December of 1998.
Good Lord Almighty.
So we're closing in on two decades. We're getting close to it.
And he has been faithful, loyal as an actor, and he's done directing. He's a playwright. And now, in his most recent incarnation, he's becoming a prolific sports author. And so you are here primarily as a kind of a co-host, mm-hmm. but to really talk about you being an author now of sports, and particularly, which sport do you tend to focus on mostly?
Well, I started with baseball. Mm-hmm. Baseball is really my first love. I went to see my first Cleveland Indians game
mm-hmm.
at Old Municipal Stadium. I sat in the bleachers with my dad. I was 8 years old. That was August of 1964.
Good Lord. That was 52 years ago.
That was a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And then not too much longer after that, in the fall of 1964, I got interested in the Browns, who were just happening to be on their way to winning the NFL championship.
Yes.
So those are the two sports that I have written about. I started writing a couple of books about baseball, a trio of books about baseball.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the suggestion of my publisher, he asked me, why don't you write something about the Browns?
Okay.
And so much has been written about the Browns over the years, it took me a while to find an idea that nobody else had written about. But I finally came up with something with the help of a couple of books that had been written about the 1972 Super Bowl champion Miami Dolphins.
I see.
Which the NFL will tell you the Dolphins are the only undefeated, untied championship team in the history of professional football, and that is absolutely wrong.
I see.
And I found two books in, I'll give them a shout out, the folks at the Euclid Library, which is my home library, the library mm-hmm. where I do most of my research. I practically grew up there. Two books had been written recently about the 1972 Dolphins, and well, I took a little offense at the claim in both books that no other team has ever made it through an NFL a professional football season. You have to delineate here because we're not talking about the NFL.
Yes.
No other team has ever made it through a professional football season undefeated, untied, and champions. And that's not true. It happened here in Cleveland back in 1948. And I had my idea. My publisher said, run with it. And so I did. So I've written two books about the Indians, one book about baseball in general, and a book about the Browns.
Okay, let's take a look and see what some of your books are like.
Okay, well, let me start chronologically, because it had always been a desire of mine to write a book about the 1920 world champion Cleveland Indians. Now, the Indians have been around since 1901. They have won only two World Series. We came so close in October of last year.
2016.
But we have won only two World Series. Everyone knows about the 1948 World Champion Indians. Lou Boudreau was the manager. Bill Veeck was the owner. So everybody mm-hmm. knows about them. But not that many people know that the Indians won the World Series in 1920.
Tris Speaker
as the manager. Tris Speaker, a Hall of Famer. There were two Hall of Famers on the 1920 Indians. I really was surprised that nobody had written a book mm-hmm. about them. So in 2009, I finally got my act together, sat down at the microfilm machine in the Euclid Library, started studying the newspapers, which is a labor of love in itself, because I am a history buff. Sports mm-hmm. history, yes, but just history in general. And the result was Tris Speaker and the 1920 Indians, which tells the story of the first world championship team ever to come out of the city of Cleveland.
How long did it take you to compile and write this particular book?
Well, it took me about a year from the time I first started taking the notes to writing to rewriting, which any writer watching today's program will understand is part of the process.
Mm-hmm.
And I took it originally to my alma mater, the Kent State Press, where the acquiring editor really liked it, but they have a process that has to be followed, and during that process the manuscript wound up being rejected.
Mm-hmm.
However, after the sting of the rejection wore off, I was able to use the critique. From what they do is they farm it out to an outside reader who is not affiliated with the Kent State University Press.
Right.
And they give you the comments from the outside reader. If the outside reader doesn't like the book, that's the end of it. They
yes.
will not publish a book that the outside reader doesn't like. And after the sting of the rejection wore off and I was finally able to look at the comments more objectively, I realized how many of them were accurate, and so I rewrote the book based on those comments and took it to a company called McFarland, which is in Jefferson, North Carolina, which, as I understand it, could easily pass for Mayberry.
Okay.
And they liked it, they published it, and they have been my publisher ever since. I've had three other books published by McFarland.
And on here, there is a chapter. Who's Miss Jameson in this Tris Speaker and the 1920s Indians book?
Miss Jameson, her name was Edna Mae Jameson,
mm-hmm.
and she was in charge of selling tickets.
For the game?
In charge of the Indians ticket office.
Oh, okay.
And it so happened that Edna Mae had worked for the team for like 6 or 7 years,
mm-hmm.
but had never seen a game.
Okay.
So the owner of the team said, you've got to take an afternoon off, because in those days all games were played in the afternoon. Stadiums did not have lights, so all games were played in the afternoon. And Edna Mae was busy in the afternoons selling tickets for that day's game or getting the tickets ready for the next day's game. The owner said, take the afternoon off and watch the game.
Mm-hmm.
Edna Mae did that, and the Indians won. So the owner, being the superstitious type, said, you're going to the game tomorrow. And they won again. And Edna Mae was then ordered, you will keep going to every game until we lose. And the Indians won 7 in a row with Edna Mae in the stands.
In the stands.
Watching for the very first time.
Now, were these played at League Park or Municipal
Stadium? Well, Municipal Stadium wasn't built until the late 1920s into the early 1930s. So this was at League Park. And when we do this program at the Rainey Institute,
mm-hmm.
which we do oftentimes, where we are right now, which is East 89th Street,
yes.
we're not too far from League Park. And
mm-hmm.
as you were talking to Tony about all the good work that has been done here in refurbishing the Caramu House and all the work that is going to be done in the future, I couldn't help but think of the money that the city of Cleveland put into refurbishing League Park.
League Park, yeah.
Certainly it has not been done on the scale that they recreated the full 22,000 seat ballpark, but
mm-hmm.
I believe the city put about $5 million
That's
into the recreation of
yes.
League Park. They spent a lot of money on it. They did a really nice job on it. And the Cleveland Baseball Heritage Museum now is in what was once the League Park ticket office, where Edna Mae Jameson used to work.
Now, do they play games there at League Park?
Yes, they do.
What do they play there?
Sandlot games are played
okay.
there. High school games are played there. And League Park was also the home of the Cleveland Buckeyes, the Negro League team. which won the 1945 Negro League Championship.
Now let's see, that was that Satchel Paige in them, or was he involved?
Yes, he was. I don't think that he played for the Cleveland Buckeyes. Of course, he did play for the Indians in 1948. Without Satchel Paige, the Indians don't win the World Series. Simple as that.
Right.
A lot of people thought that Vec signing Paige was just a publicity stunt. Vec was famous for his publicity stunts. Not so. Without Satch, the Indians would not have won the World Series. But getting back to what I was mentioning a moment ago, and I'm good at going off on tangents, as
Yeah, we still got three books to cover.
When we do this program from the Rainey Institute, we're literally like two blocks
away
from League Park. I really think it's a fortunate thing for the city of Cleveland that when League Park was torn down, except all that's left is part of the third base and left field wall and the old ticket office, which has now been refurbished into the Baseball Heritage Museum, they didn't build anything else. It was a vacant lot for years and years and years, unlike other cities which have torn down their ballparks and built upon them. In Brooklyn, where Ebbets Field used to be, it's now an apartment complex.
I see.
In Manhattan, New York, where the New York Giants used to play at the Polo Grounds, it's an apartment complex. But where League Park used to be, we didn't develop it. It remained a vacant lot so that it could be eventually refurbished and now serve as a baseball diamond for the Sandlotters, for the high school kids, and for people to be able to come and... It took my breath away, literally, to be able to walk onto that. You can walk on the field.
I see.
And I could stand where Lou Boudreau stood, where Tris Speaker stood, stand on the mound where Bob Feller stood. That was just an amazing experience for a baseball fan like me. So I wanted to tell the story of the 1920 World Champion Indians. That was how the whole thing started.
And you also are telling the story of the 1954 Cleveland Indians.
Four Cleveland Indians who still hold the American League record for the highest winning percentage, hence the title. 721, the 1954 Indians won 72.1% of their games. The victory total has since been eclipsed on a couple of occasions, but the winning percentage is still the highest in the history of the American League. Unfortunately, the 54 Indians were one of the great Cleveland flops of all time. They lost the World Series in four straight games.
Okay.
And I think that kind of explains why nobody wanted to write about them. But nonetheless, what they did up until that point was extraordinary, and I felt that the story deserved to be told, and McFarland agreed with me. So this is the story of the 1954 American League champion Cleveland Indians. Bob Feller among the players.
Was Jackie Robinson with us then in 54?
He was still playing for the Dodgers.
I see.
Jackie Robinson played for only one team in his career, and that was the Dodgers.
But wasn't he a manager here? Or
Frank Robinson. You're thinking of Frank Robinson.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
The first African-American manager was Frank Robinson with the Indians in 1975.
I see. Okay. All right, so now we've got Just Too Good. Now we switch to the Browns, the 19. Oh, you have one more.
I did another baseball book. I've always been fascinated.
I almost recognize him. Who's he?
George Steinbrenner.
Oh, my heavens.
And Billy Martin. Now, if you're a baseball fan, you know the ongoing saga of George Steinbrenner and Billy Martin through the 1970s and 80s. And being a Yankee hater of long standing, I was a little disturbed when my publisher put a couple of Yankees on the cover of my book with the Yankee pinstripes included, but actually it was a brilliant idea, whoever came up with it, because the book is about teams firing managers during the season. I have always been interested in authority figures, whether they be in politics or in sports, and I wondered empirically, when a team changes managers during the season, how often does it make a significant difference, either up or down?
And now I studied Billy Martin and Steinbrenner, didn't they flip and flop? Like, didn't he hire
Five times. Martin was hired by Steinbrenner, and five times he was fired by Steinbrenner. So really, to put this picture on the cover was a brilliant move by my publisher. So if you have any interest in managerial changes made during the season and what impact they had, this is the book to read. It is called When in Doubt, Fire the Skipper.
And where can your books be found?
These can all be found on Amazon.com.
Okay, Amazon.com.
And I know everybody shops on the internet these days, except me, but everybody shops on the internet, so you can find all of these books at Amazon.com.
Can they reach you directly if they are interested in having you come speak about your books, or do library appearances or bookstore appearances?
Well, you can get in touch with me via email.
And
let me give you my email address. It is fan1, fan2, FAN1, FAN2, at oh.rr.com.
I hope and I had that R-O-H on mine. Uh-oh. Okay.
Well,
have you been getting my email?
Okay. I mean, I'm here because you sent me an email.
Oh,
so
okay. Well, then
you must have had the RR and the .com and all that stuff where it belonged.
But check Amazon.com for any of these Cleveland Indian materials. And now we're going to switch to the Browns, and then when we finish talking about them, we will ask Gary what some of his upcoming author projects
okay.
are. So now we're going to switch to the undefeated 1948 Cleveland Browns.
And now, with so many people, young people, who only know the Browns since they returned.
Okay.
After the original team moved to Baltimore, the Browns were recreated as an expansion team in 1999, and let's face it, they have been the joke of professional football
since
they returned
in
1999. And for someone like me, who grew up when the Browns were, they used to immodestly, Art Modell used to immodestly refer to them as the greatest show in football.
Mm-hmm.
But they were. In 1964, they were the champions.
They were champions.
They played for the championship in 65, 68, and 69. No, they didn't win any of those years, but they made it to the championship game.
Mm-hmm.
I saw the first Browns game that I can remember when I was eight. The first game when I actually knew what was going on and what I was watching.
Mm-hmm.
Not until I was 18 did the Browns have a losing season. When I was growing up and the Browns would lose, it was cause for a congressional investigation. The Browns just didn't lose. They were the class of the NFL.
Now, that was the Jim Brown era?
That was just at the end. Jim Brown was with the Browns in 64 and 65,
mm-hmm.
and then retired, surprisingly and abruptly. And the Browns continued, and then Leroy Kelly came after Jim Brown
him.
And continued the tradition of great running backs. And
mm-hmm.
it wasn't until 1974 that the Browns had their second losing season. They were born in 1946. They had a losing season in 1956. Didn't have another one until 1974.
I
which
see.
Is hard for anybody under 30 years old to be able to comprehend.
Mm-hmm.
Another reason why I wrote that book, and as I mentioned in the foreword, I want the people who know the Browns as nothing but a laughing stock to know what they were years ago.
Mm-hmm.
The Browns were America's team before the Dallas Cowboys were America's team. The Browns had a radio network that stretched deep into the South. Hank Aaron, the great baseball player, still the all-time home run king for my money, grew up in Birmingham, Alabama as a Cleveland Browns fan. Why? Because the Browns games were televised into Birmingham, Alabama, and point south. Hank Aaron was a Browns fan. The Browns were the class of the NFL, and 1948, they played 15 games. They won them all. They were the champions of the All-America Football Conference, which is why you have to differentiate between the Dolphins and the Browns, because the Browns did not play in the NFL in those days. They joined the NFL 2 years later, but they played in the All-America Football Conference. But they were still undefeated, untied, and champions, and only the Dolphins have achieved that same distinction. People don't know about that. And I wanted to tell them about it. Whether you're interested or not, that
you're telling them.
The story needs to be. These guys did something extraordinary, and the story deserved to be told.
And here's a photo of the ubiquitous Paul Brown.
Paul Brown and
Lou Groza. Lou the Toe, wasn't it?
Lou the Toe.
Groza.
Yes.
I'm old enough to remember them. Did Paul Brown leave the Browns?
Paul Brown was fired after the 1962 season, mm-hmm. which was one of the great shocks in the history of Cleveland sports.
Mm-hmm.
It would be like the Cavaliers trading LeBron James for a pair of old sweat socks. Paul Brown fired? Not going to happen.
Uh-huh.
But it did. Now, there's another picture in here, Sue, that I think we should show. And let me see here. I wish I had more pictures in this book, but pictures are not really easy to come by. But the Browns...
Wait a minute, did you pass it?
Well, the All-America Football Conference had... Okay, that's not the one that I'm looking for, but I will find it. It's in here mm-hmm. somewhere. The All-America Football Conference broke professional football's color barrier in 1946. You were talking about Jackie Robinson, who broke baseball's color barrier in 1947. It happened in football in 1946.
And that was with whom?
That was with... Okay, I'm not sure if you can zero in on this picture or not, because it's only a half a page picture.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Marion Motley
and Bill Willis.
Okay, I remember Marion Motley's name.
Not sure if you can zero in on that. This is Marion Motley. This is Bill Willis. And they were the first African-American players in professional football in 13 years. Now, in the research that I did for this book, I discovered that while baseball had an unwritten rule against African-American players, no African-American had played professional baseball since 1884
uh-huh.
until Jackie Robinson joined the Dodgers.
In 1884?
No, in 1947.
Oh, okay.
Between 1884 and 1947, African-Americans were... It was an unwritten rule.
Yes.
They just were not signed by professional teams. There mm-hmm. was no bylaw in organized baseball that said no African Americans allowed,
but
nobody signed them.
Yeah.
In professional football, there had been African Americans playing, a few of them playing in the 1920s, even into the 1930s. In my research, I discovered that after the 1933 season, the National Football League held their postseason meeting and did officially add to their bylaws no black players allowed.
Wow.
So it was a written rule in the NFL. In the All-America Conference, they were born in 1946, and all they wanted was the best players that they could get. Paul Brown didn't care what color a man's skin was. If he was a good football player, Brown wanted him mm-hmm. on the team. So the Browns signed Motley and Willis, who became the first two African Americans to play professional football in 13 years. They're both in the Professional Football Hall of Fame.
And there's so much to tell, but we're running out of time now.
Yes, we are. We come.
Yes, it has come and probably gone. And as we begin to close out, what's your next project as an author? Are you doing any playwriting?
I haven't done a lot of playwriting recently because I've been so busy
doing the books and
the research. I have a couple of other books in the pipeline. I have completed a book about the history of the Cleveland Barons, the Barons of the National Hockey League. Not to be confused with the Barons of the American Hockey League, who played at the old Cleveland Arena. This was Cleveland's ill-fated two-year journey into the NHL in the late 70s. The team went bankrupt after two seasons and was merged with the team in Minnesota. So I have written about that. And I've got a whole bunch of other stuff that hopefully will be published in the not-too-distant future.
And so when you do, we will, of course, when you have the book, come back and discuss those. Plus, we'll have you back as co-host when you can break away from your many other authoring duties. You're in your daytime now, your radio position, because he's a radio announcer somewhere. Where are you? Is it
Geneva?
Geneva.
Beautiful, okay. Geneva, Ohio, in Ashtabula County.
You still like it way out there in the wilderness.
Well, they were the ones that offered me the job.
Okay.
So I took it.
We want to thank Gary Webster and all our guests this evening to be featured here on Wake Up and Live with the Arts. So we hope you enjoyed the shows. We hope you will tune in again as we bring new, exciting featured guests, actors, artists, authors, you name it, people associated with the arts, and have them share a few minutes of what's going on so that we can help expand the knowledge and interest of the arts in Northeast Ohio. So we want to thank again James McGilbray, our videographer, and Lester Bryant for doing the duties this evening. And Gary, thank you, and we look forward to seeing you again soon.
I certainly hope so.
And we will see you soon, too. Take care.